Anybody has any questions or any comments or anything like that, that's very welcome. Hallie Lewis, my daughter, is gonna do blind kid 101, and I'm basically just here to assist. I'm Tom Lewis, I'm a past president in 2009. When I was president, we were in the expo and stuff, and I wanted to press amateur winemaking like tremendously. And since we were in the expo and all, we were involved with the TFWA plus other organizations, and it was more of a professional winemaking thing. And that's basically what they're doing next door, is a professional wine. And they're doing tasting the wines of the south. Well, we have some wine that we're gonna taste, and it's the wine that Hallie made. I'll probably lose my voice before this is over. And we'll get started on the session here in a minute.
So, we're gonna start now, and I got you guys, this is gonna be a real hands-on class, this is gonna be a small class, I might have you guys come up here too. This is information, and I'll make sure this also gets online, so you guys can do one or two, just one.
Okay, and basically, there's a couple handouts here. Hallie's handed out the vintner's reserve instructions, and this is from the wine kit that she made. Here are the official instructions that come with the wine kit. Now, I kind of transferred them over to a Word document. And this wine kit is made by this company, Wine Expert. And it's in France, British Columbia, Canada, but it's translated over from France. So you'll find misspelled words and stuff like that. So we came with this American one, the Master's Vintner, and I'll pass this out to you. It's a little bit easier instructions to read. It's basically done from English, this one's done from French language and translated. Just some additional information that you may want to look at.
All right, bear with me, because I have not done a PowerPoint since high school, that was many, many years ago. And so, bear with me, because actually, my father put this together with me the other night, so I have, you guys can see the pictures.
So that's why you explained it, and I'll click it later.
There you go. So, wine kit 101, basically, the wine you were drinking is the same wine I use in my wine kit, which I actually left back there, it's got smart, isn't it? It's a heavy box. There's different kinds of wine kits, you can get concentration, you can get juice, which is what, you know, that's not been any water added to, and you have to add the water, which is everything's in it. This one is juice, and we're gonna add water to it, you can get, I read you can get cans of juice with a yeast packet. You can get frozen, you can go to a winery and get their juice and make wine. So, this is Wine Expert, World Vintner, French cab. I got it at my local fermentation station, they do wine and beer there, which you'll notice, a lot of them do both. And so, this is one, it was middle of the round, it wasn't the highest, it wasn't the cheapest. And we're gonna go through everything in this kit, it's like baking, so you're gonna follow the instructions. And with this wine, I follow the instructions, but like any kind of baker knows, or cooking, you can always change things up to stuff that you're more used to, depending on your level. So. Oh, it's already okay. So, the art of winemaking has been practiced since ancient times. Our technology has changed it into what we have today with the wine kits and the concentration, and we're going to a winery and stuff like that. The big boom actually started in 1970 when California wines didn't like the French or the Canadian juice mix. They were in cans, they weren't that great. And so they changed the industry and what it is today by having a kit with the juice and the yeast, and it was really good product. So they changed it back in 1970. They set the par level from here to up here. So that's, it's really interesting about it, but you get different products. You can do your ice wines this way. As you learned in the food pairing class, if you were next door earlier, you can almost a kit for any kind of juice out there, almost anywhere in the world. Just depends how much you want to spend, I guess. And so it's good if you don't like the muscadine grapes that are grown in this area, or the Norman, or the, you know, it's good to experiment. It's also easier and less mess, and it's very basic. Everything that you need to get going is in the kit, except for a few things that we're going to go over, like the bottles and the buckets and things like that. So just like baking a cake, you need a pan and a bowl to do it. But
so how would this be in the middle of the road? Is that like a $60 kit or a $100 kit?
I think this one was 80, okay. Around 80, 90, yeah. Because it's, you know, also pay attention when you're buying your kit. This makes 6 gallons?
Yes.
6 gallons? They make 3 gallons, they'll make 1 gallon. So this is 6 gallon. So sometimes when you're like, oh man, that's $100 and something, it could be a bigger winner. Or, man, that's $100 for 3 gallons. You know, make sure you're reading what you're getting. Just don't pick some off the shelf, because you're going to, some you add water to and some you don't. So always, always ask questions when you're buying your wine.
Okay, basically, since Bill Nash asked the question, is this wine kit was selected by Emmett Hunt. It's a Cabernet Sauvignon, and you know, that's like the standard grapes.
It's a French style.
These wine kits can vary from one extreme to the other. Allie will get into that a little bit more here in just a minute. But does anybody make wine kits? Looks like there's a lot of yes, yes, yeses. And how do you say that? Is it Bob?
Bob.
Okay. Is that a typo or am I blind?
You're blind.
I'm blind. Good to meet you, Bob. Tom Lewis.
Good to be here.
So, go to the next slide. Okay.
So, as you see in this picture here, we have this lovely box. We're going to open it up.
Okay, so we have two wine kits, one that we've made and one that we brought that's not been used. The one that Allie made was donated by a ferment station in Knoxville. That's free wine. They're also our friends.
You always want to check and make sure everything's in your box. It will have somewhere, even in the instructions or on the box, what you have. I already know everything's in here. I can see that's it.
And this box may actually have a price on it.
No, it doesn't.
It doesn't. But it's about $89.
$89.
Okay, the wine kits vary from, I'd say, $50 to $200. Is that a good range? Okay. And depending on the quality, of course. How concentrated the juice is, where it comes from, how rare it is, you know, the demand, a lot of variables, I guess.
So, as you see in the picture above, because I know you guys can really see from there, we have everything. We have the instructions, the yeast that we're going to use, the clean, everything out there. So, not only do you want to make sure that you have everything, you want to make sure that you're using it within your expiration date, like your sell by. Yeah, you can use milk after your sell by date and eggs. It's kind of more important that this has been used, like when you buy it, 3 or 4 months is what they recommend. Also, reading all your instructions. And if you don't have the instructions or you lose them, you open up, you think you're going to start at the night and you decide that you're going to do it a month later, you can always pull them up online. But most common mistake is saying, oh, I made a kit before, and not reading the instructions. You might have an F pack in there, or they might have changed the instructions for that kit, or they might have done something where you just don't need that stuff anymore, and that was a common mistake. 6 years ago, they said that they changed the instructions, and they had the most complaints, because people didn't read the instructions. They were just going, oh, I buy kits all the time. So, stuff. And I think on your guys' little thing here, it says...
It's not on the handout, because when I started the handout, this line making instructions are basically in the four steps, 1, 2, 3, 4, primary fermentation, secondary fermentation, stabilizing and clearing, and then bottling. And I didn't copy the first part, but the first part says, read all the instructions. That's something I usually don't do when I get a new toy for Christmas. I just go ahead and stick the battery in and play with it.
And I'm gonna pretend that you guys all read the instructions, and we're just gonna move on, alright? But you can kinda glance through and see, you know, what we're doing, you know, material list, instructions, and everything else. And the first thing I like to do after I read the instructions is on the backside, I like to take the label off, and I like to put it on my instructions, because I keep this on my carboy or bucket, and I like to date it so I know when I started everything, and write what kind of wine it is, because these are general instructions for almost all their wine kits. So, and some are more detailed than others, so I'll let you guys pass it around, or follow, if you guys want to follow it.
And it's basically written on the vendor's reserve instructions, starting with primary fermentation.
So.
You mentioned a while ago about expiration. They're not very precise on their expiration date. You got to call the vendor and talk to them and ask them about the numbering system.
Ah,
we actually have one that's expired that we tried to use, it did not start fermentation.
They actually
followed through and they actually sent us the new yeast. But you got to look at the code that they have on there and decipher what the date is. It's not just, hey, expired a certain day.
Is it the Julian calendar they use?
I know, so actually the number system on it, like if you look at the serial number.
Oh, it's a serial, okay. So
if you look at the number, like the first day is like the month, the second number is like whatever. But you got to basically call a vendor and ask them.
Oh.
What it is. It's not, it doesn't come out and tell you the expiration date.
That's true. That's why it's really important when you do see these wine kits sitting in your fermentations or you're ordering online that, you know, are you going through these kits? When did you order? When did you get through a distributor?
Well, it's not just when you order, it's also too when you go buy from a vendor.
Yeah.
They're selling you stuff that's 4 years old.
Exactly. So it's good to ask these questions when you're talking to the salespeople and making sure, because the worst thing in the world is to sit there and get it all started and then it not work. So.
And you mentioned the yeast. The yeast packet has an expiration date on it.
Right. But I'm just saying, when you throw it together, you have a pressure, it does take a check expiration days. Mm-hmm. And then you sit there for about 3 months like I hadn't done anything.
Right. And that's some good.
The yeast came with the kit, yes. It was expired. It didn't basically was dead.
Yeah. So.
And that's some good information. I haven't really had any problems with
that. But talking to the vendor themselves, mm-hmm. World Market, they actually told me how to look at the serial number and decipher the expiration date. Mm-hmm. Which would be nice if they put the expiration date on the box itself.
Exactly.
That would be nice. In a perfect world, right? So as you know, you're gonna need some supplies that you're not going to get in this little bitty box here. You're going to need a primary fermenter, a carboy, maybe a bottler if you're not going to your local winery and having them bottle it for you. You're going to need spoons, stirrers. As you can see, this kit right here we looked up, and this is a big caboodle starter kit. It's about $300. To get into it, this is like a high end, the best of the best. Everything you need, so you don't have to make something at home. This is about $300 to get started. They have cheaper kits for, I think it was $109. And some stuff you don't even need. Like some stuff you probably already have in the house, especially for beer, or you do other things. You might have a long spoon. You might have a turkey baster, you know, things like that. So it just depends on how much you actually want to spend to get started. And so, this was $309, and it was winetoystore.com.
Winemakerstoystore.com.
So, and then the next thing I'm going to talk about, and I'm going to stress, is sanitation. You want to make sure everything is sterile before you put it with your wine, because this is your baby right here. You're going to be doing this for a while, You know, you don't want to contaminate your baby. It's not like it has an immune system that's going to fight off any infection. And so being very sterile. So one of the things I want to talk to you guys about was sanitation. And I use, because my parents use it, so that's what I like to use. One of the things I like to use, potassium metabisulfite. I always say it's really funny. Potassium metabisulfite. Before you saw Easy Clean, another product they have out there, which I looked at their video and I never used it. The guy talked me into it, was Star Sand sanitation. It's good for beer kits. It foams. Makes me a little nervous, but if you've ever worked with it, you know how it works. Maybe not. Like, it has a little measure to your water, fill your bucket, put everything in there. And foam. He said, don't be scared of the foam, but that bothers me a little bit because I don't want foam in my wine. So, how it really works, but different things on the market. Again, ask your local supplier. With metabolic sulfite, when you get it in the powder form, it's 1 teaspoon to a quart of water, and it's the, I can't remember the amount on that one, 70.
That's 7,000 parts per million and stuff. And then the instructions that the wine kit comes in, this is 3 teaspoons per gallon, I believe. And you have the handout in your hand. What's it saying there, Bob, about sanitation? We are in the vendor's reserve instructions, whatever. maybe we're in the pre-instructions, okay. Which I did not print off. So,
just
sanitation
always...
is the most important part of wine making. Basically, when I go into my wine room, the first thing I do is wash my hands. The second thing I do is make sure I have some good fresh potassium metabisulfite.
Well, back up one screen.
I will. I don't know what I did. I told you I'm not using.
There we back go. Up another screen. It tells you right there what it is, 2 ounces per gallon.
Right.
Which is about 3 teaspoons of potassium.
Yes, correct. And this also says like 7,000.
Right.
If I can zoom in or something, you see the bottom, it says 7,000 parts per million. Which is basically a rule of thumb.
Sanitation is just.
And I'm just going to stop, and since this is an informal class, I'm going to waste some more time and drill John Stinson's head. What do you use to sanitize with, and what say percentage?
The way with I use OxyClean.
Yes. That's another good product.
And usually I get a big tub of it from the dollar store.
Right.
Generic brand. Put a little bit of citric acid in with it.
Yes.
And it foams up like a little volcano.
Exactly.
But it cleans really well.
And does everybody understand that? Or basically I'll just say an oxygen cleaner is definitely a sanitizer.
No, it's not sanitized. It's not. It will not sanitize. You have to go back over.
Okay, it's a cleaner. Okay, it's a cleaner. It's a straight A cleaner.
Yeah.
Okay.
But then I can do a bottle just like what you have.
Right, to sanitize. Okay, I'm sorry. Yeah, OxyClean is a fantastic oxygen cleaner. Okay, so I'm sorry. I need to be corrected. Thank you, John. And I do use the Oxy. Quite a bit on plastic, say like a plastic pail, perfect. Bungs, the silicone rubber bungs, perfect. The tubes, polyethylene racking tubes, perfect. That's OxyClean, works perfect to clean those. So what do you do to sanitize with?
Usually I use sodium sulfate.
Okay. Which is basically like the potassium, only a little bit different. They're both the sulfur dioxide base.
Right. Exactly. I think one of the program that Emmett did just before, the guy used sodium on something, but if you use it in your wine, it transfers some of that sodium taste into the wine. So it's a little bit cheaper than the potassium. And so I always just use it for sanitizing.
And you brought up a very good point. Anything you clean with, that's why I was telling you I was really nervous about using this because foam, it's going to change your taste of your wine. Even the container you use, plastic versus glass, or what you put in it, like your turkey base or your spoon, everything is going to change your wine formula. If you're adding a new element, you're taking something away. So remember that, you know, you don't want to transfer the germs, you don't only just want to transfer germs, you might not want to transfer a lingering taste from something else. So it is really important to clean and start with a new supply of everything. You don't want to just take this and put it over there. You know, you don't want to use water that's not filtered, maybe, because your water even is going to change the taste of your wine. Doesn't pizza dough, right? You guys hear that, Ben? Pizza dough with water, then? So here is my instructions, and I already told you I always like to take and put my label on there. That way I know. And when I store my wine, I get a little rubber band and a clip, and I put it on there, and I clip it on my carboy, or I leave my instructions on my bucket tag somewhere. One, it lets me know what wine I'm working on if I got multiple going. Two, I know where my instructions are, and I don't have to Google them later. And three, it tells me my dates, because you're going to put your date right here. And as you follow instructions, you're going to know some things are going to take 2 days, some things are going to take 14 days, and some things are going to take months. So, here we go. We're actually going to start now. Yay, are you excited? All right, so some basic wine stuff that you're actually going to need, as you saw before, you're going to need a hydrometer, you're going to need cleaning supplies. You don't have to have one of these. This is the little juice thing. It helps pop the top off and things like that. A spoon, a siphoning rod, forks, and all that is labeled. If you want to just Google wine kit making blah blah, you're going to get a list of everything. And in your instructions, it's going to say what you need. You're going to need 30 bottles. You're going to need this. So it's good to have all your supplies before you start, but you don't have to. If that makes sense. Like you don't have to have your bottles that day. Anybody want to come up here and do this and open it? Anybody want to volunteer? Everybody can get up. This is, if you guys actually want to get up and get join this part, I know it's kind of hard to see over there. But what we're going to start with, and if someone wants to bring me my instructions, okay. Come on, all of you guys can put some snacks, come up here. I'm going to borrow my instructions back though.
I think you should do it. He does beer making.
There you go.
He's done this before about beer.
So if you want to, well, let's get out of front.
Let's do it.
All right. It says, ensure your primary fermenter, so we already cleaned and sanitized it, so I took it to the back, right? We're going to add 2 liters and a half gallon of hot water to the bottom of your sanitary fermenter and stir water vigorously and slowly sprinkle in the process of package number two. So Tom is taking the hot water, and we're going to give you packet number two. Find it. It's probably not going to take it. I'm eventually going to go ahead and put it in there because he's going to store it in there.
Put it in the bag?
Mm-hmm.
All right. And that is about 600 milliliters of hot water. So we're putting it into a sanitized bucket. Oh, there we go.
Come on, guys. Stand up. And by the way, if you've never made wine before, I suggest getting a white bucket, so doing it at a clarifier. One, it has some helpful little tips on the side, like alcohol per volume and things like that. And the most important thing is it has measuring on here.
Yeah.
And on the inside, it has a line, and that is your guideline for most wine kits. And it will say fill to 6 gallons. Well, that is your guideline right there. So when you add water, as you see in here, 23 liters, that is going to be 23 liters. And so it's just an easy way. And if you wanted to, you can also put what you're doing in your bucket.
And